Okay, so I'll be talking about the interacting spin two fields and partial masslessness. Okay. So the work is based on a set of papers we wrote in the past 2 years, say. And okay, so that of the talk is at first, I will tell you very briefly about linear massive spin two fields, which have been known for a very long time, and then how would generic nonlinear extensions of these theories would look like, then the problem of ghosts that exists in these theories and has been a problem for many years. Then I will very briefly review how ghost-free nonlinear massive gravity theories can be constructed, and then I will tell you more about, so this is just at the level of words, but then I will tell you the about the structure of the biometric theory in more detail, and then we will interpret this biometric theory as a theory of a massive spin two field in a gravitational background. And then we are in a position to talk about partial masslessness, which is a phenomenon known for massive spin two fields at a linear level. Okay. So of course, large number of people have worked on these topics, and I apologize beforehand for not citing lots of relevant works here. But there are many people in the audience who have worked on this. I will only cite this work which is directly relevant to what I'm talking about here. Okay, so linear spin two fields, this theory has been known for a very long time. So this is the Fierce-Pauli equation that describes the propagation of massive spin two fluctuations, h mu nu, in a gravitational background, g bar. And this equation is, equation propagates a spin two field without a ghost. And this has been known since 1939. The interesting question, however, is how can one complete this equation to a nonlinear equation? And that seemed difficult or sometimes impossible because of a paper by Bulwer and Deiser in 72, who showed that these theories generically have a ghost. So it's very difficult to construct a theory that avoids the ghost problem. Okay. So here we will talk about the ghost-free biometric theory, which essentially is a generalization of this Fierce-Pauli equation to the case where you have a massive spin two field at the nonlinear level, which interacts with a dynamical background. So the background G bar becomes dynamical, and the massive spin two field gets promoted to a nonlinear spin two field. The simplest form of this action is what is called the biometric theory. Okay. So that's one issue. So I will talk about biometric theory, which is the most consistent generalization of the Fierce-Pauli equation to nonlinear level. And the second issue is a phenomenon which is observed for this Fierce-Pauli equation. So what's the phenomenon? Okay. So if you look at this equation of course propagates a massive spin two field, and this massive spin two field has five propagating modes corresponding to the five polarizations of the spin two field. Okay. What is the special phenomenon? So if you fix this background matrix to solve the Einstein equation in the absence of sources, but with a cosmological constant, and if this cosmological constant is positive, and you impose this relation between the mass of the massive fluctuation and the cosmological constant, this is called the Higuchi bound, then it turns out that on this bound and for these types of backgrounds, your equation develops an extra gauge symmetry. So you can transform your massive fluctuation through this kind of a transformation, where psi is an arbitrary local gauge parameter, lambda is a cosmological constant of the background spacetime, and this theory remains invariant under these local transformations, and the outcome of this is that out of the five propagating modes of the massive spin two field, one of them decouples, and you are left only with four propagating modes. This has been studied in detail for many years by Deiser and Waldron and many other collaborators. And this is interesting because in the absence of a nonlinear theory for fierce, of generic spin 2 fields, you would expect that this guy could be generalized more easily to a nonlinear form because you have an extra gauge symmetry. And of course, generically, we like gauge symmetries. They are very restrictive. So we would like to know more about this theory and if this gauge symmetry plays an important role at the nonlinear level, or is it just a fluke of the linearized theory? Okay. So, and a theory, the Fierst-Pauli theory for these kind of backgrounds on the Higuchi bound, which has this gauge symmetry, is called the partial massless theory. The partial massless theory propagates four modes rather than five. And in this case, we are sitting in a de Sitter background, and of course, there is an analogous version of this for anti-de Sitter backgrounds that Massimo Corati discussed yesterday, and Augusto, for example, has worked on this too, and many other people in the audience. So that's the anti-de Sitter version. This is the de Sitter version of the partial masslessness problem. Okay. So there is some recent work on this partial masslessness issue from the point of view of just trying to construct nonlinear extension of this theory and see to what extent this theory can be extended nonlinearly. And so there is an interesting work by Zinoviev from 2006, which just constructs cubic vertices of this massive spin 2 field by hand and tries to check when they can have this extended symmetry. And the observation is that these terms can be constructed in four dimensions. However, a more extensive analysis has been done very recently by people from here. And they show that these cubic vertices exist only in three and four dimensions. So this partial massless theories exist only in three and four dimensions if you restrict yourself to theories with two derivatives. And the claim is that if you allow for higher derivatives, then you can extend it to higher dimensions as well. But for two derivative theories, they exist only in these two dimensions. And this is just based on constructing possible cubic self-interactions of the massive spin 2 field. And for us, this will be important because when we check, when we give our proposal for partial massless theory, it will turn out that we exactly get these dimensions as the ones in which the theory exists. Okay. Very good. So we will use a different approach. We will not try to directly construct this partial massless theory with its gauge symmetry, but we will work with this bimetric theory, which is ghostly. And of course, bimetric theory is a theory of massive spin 2 fields in a gravitational background. So then it's natural to expect that the partial massless theory in a nonlinear form is in fact realized by this by a specific bimetric theory. And that's the theory that we will identify. Okay. So let's first very briefly discuss how generic theories of massive or interacting spin 2 fields will look. So if you want to construct a theory of a massive spin 2 field or a massive, what's called massive gravity generically, you have to take the Einstein-Hilbert action, which is the kinetic piece basically, and you have to add a potential term. But of course, you cannot construct a polynomial out of the matrix and its inverse alone. So you have to introduce another matrix. If you want to construct any potential involving the matrix G mu nu, you have to introduce another matrix to be able to construct something non-trivial. So you always need a second matrix. Now, generically, when people talk about massive gravity, the second matrix is put by hand, it's God-given. It's non-dynamical, and therefore the theory is artificial. You don't want a theory which has an artificial matrix. So massive gravity is not really completely okay, what wants to do with it, because it always involves an artificial, non-dynamical matrix. And even if you ignore that fact, it generically has a ghost, and that was what was shown by Bulwer and Laser. Okay, however, a more consistent theory is when you have two interacting spin 2 fields, and both of them are dynamical. So for the matrix G, for example, we use kinetic term and the potential term, And then one has to introduce a kinetic term for F. You can introduce many different types of kinetic terms. One of them, of course, has just introduced the Anish and Hilbert action also for F. So this becomes a bimetric theory, as was considered by these authors long ago. And this theory, if you look at the linear fluctuations of this theory, it has a massive mode, which is the difference of the fluctuations of the two matrices, and a massless mode, which is essentially the sum of them, with some factors that I have not written here. But this theory is again plagued by the Bulwer-Deiser Gauss, exactly like massive gravity. So there is a Gauss problem also in this theory. Okay. So what is the Bulwer-Deiser Gauss that makes the construction of interacting spin 2 theories so difficult? A generic massless spin 2 field, of course, has two propagating modes, like in general relativity. A massive spin 2 field should have five propagating modes corresponding to five different spin polarizations. But it turns out that if you write the generic theory of massive gravity, it will always have six propagating modes. Five of them is the spin 2 field, the massive spin 2 field, and the sixth one is the Bulwer-Deiser Gauss. Okay, how does the Bulwer-Deiser Gauss arise? To see that you have a Gauss, you have to do a Hamiltonian analysis, and in fact, that's the most convenient way of seeing a Gauss, so that you have the physical content of the theory. So the matrix has generically 10 components in four dimensions. In the ADM parameterization, you parameterize it in terms of the space-space components, and you have six of them. So gamma ij has six components. Then you look at space time, you look at the zero mu components, and these are parameterized by the lapse function, by one lapse function and three shift functions. So the standard ADM parameterization of the matrix. And in general relativity, it turns out that if you write the Anish and Hilbert action in this parameterization, it makes it very obvious that the six components of gamma ij are dynamical because they come with a time derivative, but the four components n and ni are non-dynamical because they do not contain any derivatives when you write the action in the Hamiltonian formalism. So you have six potentially propagating modes in gamma ij, and this of course means 12 degrees of freedom corresponding to the field and its canonically conjugate momentum. What happens in general relativity, of course, is that these fields are Lagrange multipliers. Their equations of motion force give rise to four constraints. So you have four constraints on the fields. And moreover, you have four general coordinate transformations. And these eight conditions reduce the 12 degrees of freedom to four. So you have 4 degrees of freedom, which means two propagating modes. And those are exactly the two propagating modes of the graviton, even at the nonlinear level in Anish and Hilbert theory. In massive gravity, the moment that you introduce the mass potential, you make the theory, you make the action nonlinear in n and i. Now in this theory, you have no constraints because these n and i are not Lagrange multipliers, and you have no symmetries. So at the end of the day, all components of gamma ij survive as dynamical fields. Five of them is a massive spin 2, and the last one is the Gauss. You can show that the last one is the Gauss. So this essentially is the proof of Bulwer and Deiser, that generically these theories have Gausses. The caveat, however, is that one can construct very special forms of this potential that avoid the Gauss problem. However, as you will see, this potential, this special form is very, very special, so it's not easy to immediately guess what that form is. However, in hindsight now, one can actually derive the exact form of this potential just from these conditions, just trying to avoid these conditions. So below, I will describe roughly how this potential was really constructed historically. But I will just describe it. I will not give you the proofs. Okay, so how does the construction of Gauss-free nonlinear massive gravity go? So it turned out that if you really want to work with gravity, things become very complicated, life becomes very complicated, you cannot make out anything, you cannot even identify the Gauss easily, you just know that it's there. So to construct nonlinear massive gravity theories, some other development was needed, and that was the use of the so-called decoupling limit. So people realized that they could analyze the Gauss in a certain limit, which extremely simplified the theory. It essentially picked up the Gauss and it kind of threw away the gravity part. So there was a lot of this development based on this decoupling limit analysis. I will tell you in more detail about it right now. And then to go beyond that, one needed Hamiltonian method, because decoupling limit analysis answers some simple questions, but essentially it is perturbative. And moreover, it's a form of perturbation theory where it becomes very difficult to go to higher orders in perturbation theory. So for further development, one needs the Hamiltonian methods. And I will briefly discuss the questions that cannot be addressed here and which are essentially solved by using the Hamiltonian methods. Okay, so essentially the progress in constructing these theories is based on decoupling limit methods and then exact nonlinear Hamiltonian methods. Okay, so the decoupling limit, the decoupling limit analysis basically says that you have to start with a matrix. You look at linear perturbations of the matrix. You take a flat F mu nu, and you introduce Stueckelberg fields and just take the longitudinal part of that, so you just get a scalar field I. So decoupling limit means taking a limit of the theory in which you work not with gravity but with a scalar field I in flat space, which is of course much simpler than gravity. So this was proposed here. And then Cremonelli, Nicolis, Papucci, and Trincherini, they used this approach and they constructed a potential which they could show that in the decoupling limit, when you ignore this edge, so to zero it other than this edge perturbation, this potential was ghost free. So they actually got the ghost free structure of this potential. And then finally, Diram and Gavadas, they could show that this potential actually was also ghost free to linear order and edge. And then this was actually generalized to, once you have this potential in fact to zeroth order and edge, then you can uniquely construct the complete nonlinear form of the potential, and it involves a square root matrix. So this potential was constructed by Diram, Gavadarse, and Tolli in 2010, and they could show that this was ghost free in the decoupling limit. So what are the problems that the decoupling limit cannot address? It cannot tell you that the theory is ghost free completely nonlinearly away from the decoupling limit. And moreover, of course, we would like to know if the second matrix can be any generic matrix, not just a term union. This cannot be done in the decoupling limit. And also making F dynamical. So these are issues which are of interest to us. We essentially want to work with these theories, but the decoupling limit cannot do that. So we have to use the nonlinear Hamiltonian methods, which are essentially exact nonlinear methods. And the problem essentially is to deal with a square root matrix. Okay, but one can actually deal with that. So one can prove that the theory, this massive gravity theory constructed in this way by Diram, Gavadarse, and Tolli, is exactly ghost-free at a nonlinear level. There are constraints that one can find exactly. Moreover, the matrix A term mu nu can actually be promoted to a generic F mu nu matrix, and the theory still remains ghost-free. One can again show that at a complete nonlinear level. And also, one can find the correct kinetic term for F mu nu that keeps the complete, keeps the dynamical theory with both F and G dynamical ghost-free, and that's the bimetric theory. And these constructions have also been then extended to interactions of several field binds or several matrix. Okay. So how does the theory look like, the biometric theory? So for that, I will make a small digression. First, let's consider the elementary symmetric polynomials of a matrix X. So take some matrix with eigenvalues lambda 1 to lambda 4 in 4 dimensions. Then these are the elementary symmetric polynomials of the eigenvalues of the matrix. These are quite well known. Instead of working with the eigenvalues, you can also write the elementary symmetric polynomials E0 to EK in any dimension in terms of the matrix themselves. So for the matrix X, this square bracket denotes a trace. So this is the expression for the elementary symmetric polynomials of the eigenvalues of the matrix in terms of the matrix itself. In four dimensions, these are the expressions. So generically, EN goes as X to the power N. Okay, now these guys, the elementary symmetric polynomials are related to determinants, and in fact the determinant of 1 plus the matrix becomes a sum of the elementary symmetric polynomials of the matrix, the elementary state facts. And you can also write this determinant in terms of, you can expand it in terms of two anti-symmetric tensors, two auxiliary tensors basically. Okay, this is the determinant. Now let's introduce the notion of a deformed determinant. So you just take this determinant and introduce coefficients beta n here. Okay, so that's a deformed determinant. You have deformed it by taking not linear combinations with identity here, but linear combinations with beta n here. That's the notion of a deformed determinant that you can introduce. And then the observation is that the Gauss-free potential that was constructed for massive gravity is exactly this deformed determinant. So it's exactly given in terms of the elementary symmetric polynomials of the square root matrix. And realizing this is very important in developing the theory further. Okay. Now, the Gauss-free bimetric theory that we want to construct involves two kinetic terms for G and F, and this interaction potential in terms of the symmetric polynomials, elementary symmetric polynomials. And one can show that exactly this combination of kinetic terms keeps the theory Gauss-free. So you need this kinetic term and not other type of kinetic terms. And there is a symmetry property for the potential. So the potential written in terms of G inverse F or F inverse G essentially is the same. And this is responsible for making the theory symmetric under the interchange of G and F matrix. One can do an ADM analysis of this theory at a completely nonlinear level and show that you have 2 plus 5, that is 7 propagating modes. Okay? At the nonlinear level, you cannot see what these propagating modes are. But if you analyze the theory at the linear level, you can see that these five correspond to a massive spin 2 and the 2 correspond to a massless spin 2 field. So this is a theory of massive spin 2 plus a massless spin 2 field. Okay. However, how do we really interpret this theory as a theory of massive and massless spin 2 fields? They're completely free, except for the very general conditions that restricts their ranges. For example, the Fierst-Pauli mass of the Cartesian should not be negative or imaginary. So they are not fixed to special values, but their ranges are fixed. Yeah. Okay. So the question is now, how can this bimetric? So we have constructed a bimetric theory. It's a theory of two interacting spin 2 fields, G mu nu and F mu nu, and we kind of have a feeling that this describes massive spin 2 plus massless spin 2, but in more detail, how can we really interpret this as a theory of massive spin 2 fields? That's not very obvious from this action, which treats the two matrix on the same footing. So that's what we can consider now. Okay, so that's the bimetric action in D dimensions. You can write it in any number of dimensions. You just have to add the corresponding elementary symmetric polynomials, which are more in number in higher dimensions. So the question is, in what sense is this a theory of masses spin two fields? And okay, so first of all, what do you mean by mass generically? In a generic curve background, the notion of mass, of course, does not exist. But here, by mass, we simply mean a Fierst-Pauli mass for a fluctuation. Does this theory have a fluctuation, some combination of the fluctuations of G and F matrix that had a Fierst-Pauli mass term? So that's what we mean by mass in generic backgrounds. And then it turns out that Fierst-Pauli mass terms in this theory do not exist for generic bimetric backgrounds. If you just look at some backgrounds for G and F, generically, you don't get a Fierst-Pauli mass term for excitations. Okay, and even when you get Fierst-Pauli mass terms, then delta G and delta F are not massless eigenstates. So the fluctuations of the two matrix are not massless, are not mass eigenstates by themselves. So we have to find the correct eigenstates. And the other question, of course, is to what extent does this theory deviate from GR? Once you regard this as a theory of a massive spin 2 field, you can interpret it as a theory of massive spin 2 field coupled to gravity. And then, of course, if you want to really conjecture that this may be realized in nature, you would like that this theory does not give you appreciable deviations from general relativity. So how do you identify gravity and this combination of G and F. Okay. So to address these questions, first we have to look at a special kind of background. It turns out that only around proportional backgrounds, if you take these answers for the backgrounds that are proportional to each other, only for these backgrounds you get Fierce-Pauli mass term for the fluctuations. If you don't look at these backgrounds, your fluctuations will not have Fierce-Pauli mass term. So we look at these kind of backgrounds. In these backgrounds, it turns out that the equations of motion reduce exactly to Einstein-Hilbert equations. So these are backgrounds where your matrix look exactly like solutions of Einstein-Hilbert equations with some cosmological constants and some sources, but the sources have to be correlated. Here, for most of the talk, I will set sources to zero, so we look at cosmological equations. The two cosmological constants can be determined exactly in terms of this parameter C and the other parameters of the theory. And the two equations are consistent if you have this condition on cosmological constants. Okay. Whether you have sources or not, it doesn't matter. The two cosmological constants that you get for the G and F sector have to be equal. And this exactly is an equation for the coefficient C. Okay, so that determines C. It determines the coefficient, the proportionality constant C in terms of the parameters of the theory. Okay? Generically, except for one special case when C is not determined, and that is a partial massless case, as I will argue in a while. So if you want to find, if you want to look at the mass spectrum of bimetric theory, you have to look at proportional backgrounds, and then the constant of proportionality is determined by the theory itself. Alpha is the alpha here is the ratio of the Planck masses, and beta n's are essentially the parameters and the interaction potential. Okay. Now around the so these backgrounds have two advantages. First of all, they allow you to have fluctuations with Fierce-Pauli mass terms, as we will see now. Secondly, the background themselves just turned out to be GR backgrounds. So massive and massless fluctuations, definite massive and massive fluctuations exist only around general relativity background, even in the bimetric theory. Okay, so then if you look at linear fluctuations, you have two linear modes. This mode is massive, that mode is massless. Okay, so you can construct a mode, a fluctuation delta capital G mu and delta capital M mu nu. This is a massless, the massive mode, this is a massless mode. If you look at the corresponding equation, this is exactly the massless, this is the linearized GR equation. So this is a massless spin 2, and this is exactly a Fierce-Pauli equation with a given mass and a given cosmological constant. So the mass and cosmological constant are given. This is the Fierce-Pauli mass of the fluctuation in general d dimensions. Okay? So this is exactly the Fierce-Pauli equation. Now the one question you may ask is, can I promote these fluctuations to nonlinear fields? And it turns out that yes, you can actually define nonlinear fields that, when linearized, give you those fluctuations. Okay? These nonlinear fields are not unique, but this is a unique combination where you can invert the relation between capital G and capital M, that's the mass eigenstates in the original fundamental G mu and F mu fields. Okay? Otherwise, you can write infinite number of very complicated relations between them, but this is the one that's invertible. In fact, there are two easy ones that are invertible. This is the one. It's one of them. Okay, so these are, so you would like to now interpret these as your nonlinear, massive, and massless modes. Okay? And once you have this, then you can ask, okay, now, can this massless mode be gravity? And the answer is that it cannot be. Why? Because even though you can express the action in terms of capital G and capital M, the massive and the nonlinear, massive, and massless modes, you can show using an AD, a Hamiltonian analysis that this massless mode cannot couple to matter in a ghost free way. If you write standard couplings of this massless, of this mode G mu to matter, they will contain a ghost. Okay, so this massless mode is not gravity. Okay. Okay. So if you want to describe therefore a theory of a massive spin 2 field interacting with gravity, then you have to use these variables. The original G mu nu in a massive field. Okay. Okay. And also, the massive field has an expectation value. Zero expectation value for the massive field means that you have exactly general relativity backgrounds, and any deviation of the background value of the massive field from zero parametrizes deviations of your theory from GR. The deviation of the theory from general relativity are parametrized by the vacuum expectation value of the massive field, basically. Okay, so now we have recasted this, bimetric theory as a theory of massive spin 2 and massless spin 2. And now, of course, we are in a position to ask our questions about partial masslessness in this theory. Okay, so this is a nonlinear theory of massive spin 2 fields. Can we see partial masslessness in this or not? Okay, so the question for the follows: how do we even identify a partial massless candidate in this business? And that turns out to be extremely simple. Like, it's just back of the envelope calculation. So what do? If you had a partial massless theory, you have this symmetry. We wrote down this symmetry in the second slide. This is a symmetry, this is the extra gauge symmetry of the partial massless theory that acts on the massive mode, and it keeps the massless mode unchanged. From here, you can translate this transformation. Okay, you can first of all look at the transformation with constant gauge parameter. This is the subset which is relevant for our discussion here. And then translate this into the transformation of fluctuations of the fundamental field, delta G and delta F. See, we get these kind of fluctuations. Now, the crucial point to realize is that in this theory, we are working with a dynamical field, G mu nu. So the small G mu nu is a fluctuation of a dynamical field. And whenever you have completely dynamical field with a symmetry, the breakup of the field into background and fluctuation is a little arbitrary. You can always take the background, you can always absorb a symmetry transformation from the fluctuation into the background, and that gives you another reasonable background. Okay? So that's what you can do here. Because of the fact that your G mu nu and F mu nu are completely dynamical in this theory, whenever you have a symmetry transformation, if you assume that your theory has a completely nonlinear symmetry acting on G mu nu and F mu nu, that symmetry, infinitesimal symmetry transformation of that kind can be shifted between the fluctuation and the background. Okay? That's always possible. So when we obtain, if this is the form of the gauge, partial massless gauge transformation on the fluctuations, and these fluctuations are around dynamical backgrounds, we can also reformulate this with untransformed fluctuation, but transformed background. Okay? So these transformations can be shifted to the background. But if you shift these transformations to the background, you can of course just see how the backgrounds transform. And our backgrounds are again proportional to each other. We started with proportional backgrounds. You can again check that they are proportional to each other, but with a different value of C. You can just look at this, set them, put them here, and compute your new C. The proportionality constant is not the same as the old one. Okay? But I told you in the beginning that once you make this proportional answers, then the proportionality constant is uniquely determined by the theory. You have no freedom in moving that. Okay? So if in this way you shift your backgrounds with a new C, these backgrounds are no longer solutions. Okay? Which means that the symmetry that you started with is not really a symmetry of your theory. If you work with a real symmetry, you transform your background with a symmetry, they have to remain solutions of the equation, because you transform them with a symmetry. So here, if this was a symmetry of the complete theory, you transform your backgrounds, they are no longer backgrounds, so this is not a symmetry. Okay? So this partial massless symmetry cannot be extended to the backgrounds in this case, simply because the value of the proportionality constant is determined by the theory. And your symmetry here means that this should not be determined. It should be arbitrary. It should depend on the gauge parameter. So it's obvious that the only possible case where your nonlinear theory could have a version of this partial massless gauge theory is where your theory does not determine this proportionality constant. Okay? The proportionality constant in this answer should remain undetermined by the theory. And then you go back to the equation that determines C. Okay, so I told you that the proportionality constant is determined by the condition that the cosmological constants of the two sectors should be equal. You look at that equation, And you see that whenever the coefficient of each power of C is zero separately, the equation does not determine C. Okay? And there is a non-trivial solution to that here. Okay? So this is the solution. These are the values of the parameters of the bimetric theory, beta 1, beta 3, 0, and essentially you have just beta 2. Okay? And for which your backgrounds could have a version of the partial massless symmetry. So what you get from here, obviously, is your candidate partial massless action. So this is the partial massless theory. This is the candidate theory. So if there exists a partial massless theory, this has to be it, basically. Okay? And you just have one free parameter here, and that free parameter essentially is related to the mass of the Fierst-Pauli Cartesian. So how do we try to verify this? Just compute the Fierst-Pauli mass and the cosmological constant in terms of the parameters. We know their value separately. And for this choice of parameters, when you compute them, it exactly puts you on the Higuchi bound. Okay? And this is, okay, so we did not impose the Higuchi bound in this theory. We just assumed that the theory should have a symmetry. And we automatically got the Higuchi bound out. But now our theory is much more constrained by this, because the Higuchi bound gives one condition on the parameters. However, here we have all parameters determined, basically. Okay? So we have a nonlinear extension of the Higuchi bound. The second check that you can do is to look at partial masslesses in general dimensions. Okay? And as people here have shown, and I told you in the beginning, you expect that you should get a partial massless theory only for 3 and 4 dimensions based on the analysis of the cubic vertices that people here did. And if you look at this theory, it exactly tells you that for D greater than 4, there is no partial massless theory. Okay? If you look at the analog of this equation for D greater than 4, then you will see that all beta n's vanish. All the parameters of the bimetric theory vanish, so there is no partial massless theory beyond 4 dimensions. Okay? And in fact, the special form of nonlinear gauge transformation that we had here for constant gauge parameter, you can actually check that also in this setup, and you see that that actually is a transformation, that actually is a symmetry. But we still do not know the complete gauge symmetry of the theory. Okay? So the conclusion. So the conclusion is that we have candidate partial massless theories at a complete nonlinear level. They automatically satisfy the Higuchi bound, and some subsets of the partial massless gauge transformation can be realized in those theories. We know how to realize them. And these are essentially theories of a massive spin 2 field interacting with a dynamical massless mode G at a completely nonlinear level. But the nonlinear version of this symmetry is not yet known. We do not exactly know the nonlinear version of this symmetry. So we do not exactly know if this final theory really propagates 5 massive spin 2 modes or just 4 of them corresponding to a massless theory. And that is the end of my talk.
If you read the Zinoviev paper carefully, he has a claim that there is no cortic vertex.
Yeah.
No cortic. I even wrote him an email to check.
In 4 dimensions?
In 4, yeah.
We have not checked that. So even the cubic vertex, we have not checked explicitly, simply because the cubic vertex vertices that he computes and the ones that people here, Tarona and Karabatis, compute, they're all computed on shell. Okay? And for us, it's easier to compute things off-shell in the action, because on-shell things becomes, you have to put in the equation of motion, so things become completely arbitrary. I mean, okay, arbitrary to a large extent. So we have not checked these terms explicitly, but what this tells you is that if there exists an extension of partial massless, that's the nonlinear level, this has to be the theory.
Okay? He claims there's no cortex, but he doesn't give the calculation.
Yeah, but so I think he also claimed that these things do not exist in three dimensions. So we get a three-dimensional partial masses candidate, and I talked to people here yesterday, and they also get one.
So maybe it needs to be
At least when I look at those computations, they are not very straightforward. I mean, you have to essentially construct large number of terms, and if I did that calculation, I would not trust myself.
He's a careful guy.
Okay. I don't know. I have not checked it, so if there is anything, this is the candidate. Maybe there is no partial massless theory in, at the nonlinear level. Yeah.
Reason. Well, okay, I have a very general question concerning these quasi-determinant terms. Sometimes it's easier to understand the structure of the theory using the Stickelberg formalism.
Yeah.
So is it would it be correct to say that these specific interactions between these two spin two are in the Stickelberg formalism actually are selected by the condition that the Stickelberg fields don't have hard time derivatives. So this anti-symmetrization probably will not allow to have too many time derivatives. Is that correct or not?
It's partly correct, yes. So the point is that there is a correlation between the number of time derivatives of the Stickelberg field and the ghost in the matrix sector. The ghost does not sit in the Stickelberg sector. Okay? Because Stickelberg sector is a gauge sector. You can shift it by gauge transformations. But if you look at the ghost in the Fierce-Pauli theory, if you tune the mass term away from the Fierce-Pauli value, you get a ghost. That ghost actually is a gauge invariant ghost. So the so they are correlated. Yes, you're right. They are correlated, but okay. Let me put it in a different way. They are correlated. Yes, but if you want to use that information, it becomes very difficult to analyze things away from the decoupling limit. Okay. So we have also done this Hamiltonian analysis. We have also done it for the Stickelberg fields, because when people did this for the decoupling limit, again there, they could not show that the ghost in the Stickelberg sector was completely absent for generic non-trivial G mu nus. So the decoupling limit is G mu nu almost flat, and look at the Stickelberg sector. But you can do the Hamiltonian analysis, and again you can see that even in the Stickelberg formalism there is no ghost. So you are right, yes, there is a correlation, but if you do not work in the decoupling limit, it's not very obvious how to study one just within the other one.
Waiting for us, so let's thank our speaker again.